This is The Baseline, discussing the hot button topics of the NBA.
Welcome, everybody. You are tuned to The Baseline. Cali, Warren Shaw, discussing the hot button topics of the NBA. And if I were to tell you Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, basically combine for less than 30 points in an NBA Finals game, what would be the probabilities that the Golden State Warriors wind up winning the game against a Cleveland Cavaliers team with LeBron James? Single digits? No. Maybe double digits. That would be a conspiracy theory. But the Golden State Warriors yet again prove why the numbers can at times make you look foolish as we talk NBA Finals action. And you know, the hoopla surrounding these two teams, there's a lot of animosity brewing. So, you know, I got to get it all and break it all down with my right-hand man, 50 Grand NBA Fishing out of Dimeac, contributor, writer for one of the illest websites. My brother from another mother, Mr. Warren Shaw, repping out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. You can always catch him on www.shawsports.net. Mr. Shaw, Steph Curry, Klay Thompson collectively don't drop 30, and yet they still find a way to go double D on the Cleveland Cavaliers.
Absolutely an amazing performance by Golden State's defense and their bench. But first of all, salute to you and all the fans and listeners of the NBA Baseline tuning in here as we break down game one of the NBA Finals. And yeah, I was amazed to see Golden State defense just tighten up the screws. And it goes to show, you know, when we had a discussion in our finals preview, we talked about other Warriors stepping up and being seen and being heard from in this series. And my God, did they get those performances tonight in an evening where Steph and Klay actually had to take a back seat. Curry doesn't even cross double digits until late in the fourth quarter with a late three that kind of superly sealed the game for them. I was just so impressed, more so even just with the overall defense by Golden State. Andre Iguodala, again, showing that he is a man-child when it comes to the defensive side of basketball, and then doing all the little things to help the Golden State Warriors, not to say pull out this win, to run away with this win as it came down to it, escaping 104-89.
Yeah, definitely. And an impressive defensive effort by the Golden State Warriors. An impressive clutch performance by the whole Golden State Warriors bench. And we'll talk a little bit more about what that contribution could mean as we further ourselves into the series. And what kind of adjustments should the Cleveland Cavaliers be making after the effort that they've put forth in this Game 1 Finals? A lot of stuff to get into, but first and foremost, we'd like to thank the listeners and all of the heads who have been tuning in to the Baseline Baseline NBA podcast for all of this time. You know how to get at my man Shaw at Shaw Sports NBA. We always say you can get at me at Game Face Lee, but we always encourage you to get the show's Twitter handle at NBA Baseline. Now, my man Shaw pulled the trickery on me. We have now officially changed the Twitter handle. It's at NBA Baseline. So be sure to check us out. We're available on all the major platforms, available on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Microsoft TuneIn, Player FM. And then we're also available on Google Music. And my man Shaw also has our audio on display for our Roku head. So use any one of these platforms and allow us to be your go-to resource as we discuss the NBA Finals. And more importantly, Shaw, as we get into this discussion and we break down the differences between the two teams and what we've seen from this game one performance, I think the biggest caveat that we really have to look at is Steph Curry and LeBron James and what is the dynamic between what both of these guys bring to the table, their cachet, their resume, may not even significantly be the most important factor to who wins this championship. Because while there's that internal struggle going on, we're seeing some other interesting lines develop. And some of those interesting lines that are developing, Shaw, are coming from players who are not necessarily in the spotlight. But usually when it matters the most, and you look at their stat sheets, they will have a significant impact, yet again, that might be definitive to whether or not the Golden State Warriors repeat as NBA champions or the Cleveland Cavaliers finally winning a championship for the land.
You're 100% correct, man, because you always look at the stars in any series and figure, okay, you're going to get the production that you need from those guys. And it always comes down to the supporting cast of teams, especially in games like the NBA Finals, and whether or not those guys are able to step up to it. And typically, you know, the old adage is your role players will play great at home and they'll struggle on the road. And I think that was proof positive, at least in game one, as see a guy like Sean Livingston explode off the bench for 20 points on 8 of 10 shooting from the floor, just killing him with the mid-range and getting into the lane, and was well defended, especially early on. Shumpert played some pretty decent defense on him, but he was just hitting those shots. Then you get a guy like Leandro Barbosa, who had pretty much been missing most of the series. I mean, most of the playoffs. He comes in now, drops 11 points as well. Andre Iguodala, as we mentioned a little bit earlier, doing it on both sides of the basketball floor, but with 12 points, 7 rebounds, 6 assists, and just, you know, timely strips and getting in the way in the defensive side of things. Again, this was really a great, great performance from the Golden State bench, but a piss poor performance for the Cleveland Cavaliers bench, as you know, even the Cavaliers stars all struggled. They all got their numbers from an aesthetic, I think, viewpoint, but they all struggled from the field, and then they didn't get any help from any of the supporting cast: Channing Frye, Iman Shumpert, Richard Jefferson, Dellavedova. All those guys, they all struggled to score and weren't able to produce anything. And these are the types of adjustments now you kind of have to wonder, where does Lou now try to get some production from that Cleveland bench?
The Cleveland Cavaliers tonight, Shaw, basically committed the ultimate sin, which is to allow the Golden State Warriors to impose their strength in numbers mentality. Sin. That's it. I mean, if nothing else, Tyronn Lue should be sitting inside that locker room and saying, "Thou shalt not sin. Thou shalt not let the Golden Warriors sin. When the Golden Warriors sin, you stand no chance of winning any basketball games." It's been proven in the regular season, because we can sit here and make all the excuses of the players that didn't participate during the regular season series, in which the Golden State Warriors, I believe, won all three of those games, correct? So what we're talking about here is, who should the Cleveland Cavaliers truly be when it matters the most to help win this championship? And the one thing that I'm finding that I think is going to rear its ugly head is, and we said this, you know, in our previous podcast, Shaw, which LeBron James is going to have to be a part of the finals? Is it the LeBron James who last year in game one dropped 44 points, who basically shouldered this Cleveland Cavaliers team to single-handedly put themselves in a position to even be in contention for a championship, even though the surrounding pieces around him just didn't step up as big as he did? Or is it this LeBron James that is so happy, so content, so relieved that he's finally got a healthy Kyrie Irving, finally got a healthy Kevin Love, he's got that Channing Frye guy that he wanted, and then, you know, he was able to keep his big dog, his enforcer, Tristan Thompson, to stay with him one more, five more years to play for the land? Is he going to be that dude that's content, that he thinks that he's finally got exactly what he wants, and yet these guys are still not going to be enough to help him win the championship, because they need the LeBron James, the killer LeBron, the Black Mamba LeBron, to step up and help him win these basketball games?
Well, there were times you saw those guys, Love specifically, deferring to LeBron. I was like, no, man, you take it. You go and need to do. And I think LeBron was force-feeding these guys to try to get them.
They needed a Durant moment. You remember when Durant went off on Robeson? LeBron needs to go off on Kevin Love, J.R. Smith, on maybe even Kyrie Irving. Shoot the damn ball. That's the kind of moment LeBron is going to have with this Cavaliers team, because they cannot afford to do what they did tonight, deferring at the wrong time.
Well, and I think the caveat to that is, you know, because they all three of those guys, they were the three team leaders in shots taken in game one. Kyrie actually shot 22 shots, LeBron 21, Love 17. Next closest guy was 11 with Tristan. But what it boiled down to is that they lacked the ball movement, and they allowed Golden State's defense to step up and really sit on them. They were standing up Love in the post. There was a lot of action on one side of the basketball floor instead of, you know, swinging the ball and then maybe even swinging it down and swinging it back out and keeping the Golden State defense moving and switching. I just felt like the offense lacked imagination tonight, and that's not something that we've seen traditionally throughout the playoffs with Cleveland, you know, as they continue to move the ball, and that's why they shoot and make a lot of threes, because the ball movement gets them those open shots. And that really just didn't happen tonight. I think it could have been game one jitters, the whole nine. And I think LeBron is in his teaching phase right now, you know, trying to be the sensei and trying to say, hey, guys, we're going to need you all to participate. But I think that's still a little bit on Lou as well, too, is like, yo, what happened to the ball movement that we've seen and become to really enjoy with this Cavaliers in the 2016 playoffs?
Shaw, let me add on something to the point that you were just mentioning about the unimaginativity of the Cavaliers' offensive scheme and what they were doing, especially with Kevin Love. I don't have a problem with the idea, because this has been the bread and butter since Tyronn Lue took over from David Blatt as the head coach for the Cleveland Cavaliers during the All-Star break. Their intent was that they wanted Kevin Love down in the post. And I don't have a problem with that. As a matter of fact, I think that that is a very good strategy if you're the Cleveland Cavaliers. Because ultimately, in the beginning, when you have LeBron James running roughshod, which he was in the early outset of the game, he basically was forcing the Warriors to collapse, giving them the space and wanting them to collapse into a window of Warriors players. Then now you get the bigger guy, Kevin Love, in the second half, who establishes himself in the post, and then he can create. But the problem is that Kevin Love was not making them hurt. He was not punishing the Warriors while he was collapsing on the post. You look at it tonight, he only had one free throw. One free throw. I mean, there is no way. I'm not sorry, not one free throw. He only had one free throw tonight. There is no way that you're going to tell me that this particular plan in setting Kevin Love down in the post and having him camp out there with a good Warriors defensive team effort wise, is going to play unless Kevin Love is going to punish those that he's either. There were many times where Kevin Love had Steph Curry on him. There were times where Kevin Love had Klay Thompson on him with two fouls already, and we hadn't even gotten to the second half. There were times Kevin Love had Harrison Barnes on him. But to only walk away with only one free throw attempt is telling me he's either too comfortable out by the three, or he is not thinking attack, which is something that LeBron was thinking in the beginning. You cannot afford to do that if your main scheme is to put Kevin Love down there in the post. Somebody's got to make the Warriors pay down low. Remember, the Warriors are still the smaller basketball team in height in comparison to the Cavaliers. And so now Steve Kerr has the luxury of running a small lineup out there because they know that Kevin Love is not going to make them pay in the post.
I mean, I think that's a good point too. Love is not as adept, I think, as he used to be, you know, getting to the hole and, you know, doing jump hooks and fadeaways and things like that. But I got to credit the Warriors defense here, because there was a point where he had Livingston on him and Livingston was actually able to stand him up in the post where he couldn't get the position that he wanted to. And then Golden State did another great job in terms of having Draymond at times kind of play center field, if you will, and sit in the lane. And then they would double, and then Love is, again, he's just not great at passing out of the post, as especially when he's off balance or in the rhythm of his shot motion. So then he's trying to adjust now and trying to find people or trying to throw up something that's off balance and has no chance of going in. I think the Golden State defense is just caught them by surprise to some degree in terms of, like, they didn't think, okay, yeah, we have a mismatch with Love, okay, let's try to go for it. But then double teams and sometimes triple teams would come. Again, that's something Lou is going to have to figure out and look at the game one film and say, okay, well, if we get Love in these situations again, what are we going to do? Or is it that we run a different action and pick and roll to try to find a different person on the block, if you will? I think early on, I think LeBron is maybe the guy you want to try to play through on the post, especially if Kerr is going to continue to start Barnes out there, and, you know, Barnes and Klay will take their turns, and maybe Draymond will come over as well. But then that's when Tristan needs to be diving to the rim and trying to get those easy layups. I mean, the middle part of the third quarter, the Cavaliers looked really, really good offensively and defensively. And you can really see that it was sparking both sides of the basketball. Their offense picked up and it sparked their defense and their interest as they got back into the game. But again, if they don't get those easy looks, and you know, whether or not they're playing through Love or they're playing through LeBron on the post, they got to find a different way to continue to get the ball moving that's necessary that can get them the shots that they are very capable of making.
Cal Lee, Warren Shaw of the Baseline NBA podcast. Be sure to check us out at NBA Baseline. Okay, Shaw, so we're looking at what the Cavaliers didn't do right. And while we were very much impressed with the Golden State Warriors offensively, I still don't even think that this was considered their most efficient and their best offensive effort collectively by everybody, but it was definitely their deepest effort. And let me put it like this. I think tonight the Golden State Warriors bench just basically said, Steve Kerr, we're sorry. Like, we harped on how the last three games of the Western Conference Finals came down to historically dominating superstar, hero come and save me. I feel like I'm Celine Dion, Whitney Houston, you know, singing praises to Steph and Clay type performances. And you can sprinkle a couple of Andre Iguodala defensive efforts. Tonight, it was about the bench. And because we talked about how the bench was just so bad for the Warriors in that series. Either the Thunder made them look bad or they just were non-existent. And tonight, we saw exactly why we and a lot of people felt like it doesn't matter if Kevin Love and Kyrie Irving are at full strength. If this Warriors team all plays to the abilities that put them on this roster to begin with, there is no way that the Cavaliers are going to be able to keep up with them. And tonight we saw a perfect example of that. And it still did not look like a crisp performance. Forget the numbers that Curry and Klay Thompson didn't give you. I applaud the fact that they gave them a lot more from a defensive perspective to hold it down when it was necessary, since they couldn't contribute offensively. And they basically let the rest of the team do the offensive grunt work.
Yeah, no, they absolutely did. And I think that's, again, you want to give credit to guys like Clay and Curry, who understand, hey, I may not have it going tonight, but I'm not going to be out here and just being a bum on a log. I've got to figure out a way to contribute. And I think Curry especially did a really good job in trying to contest a lot of Kyrie's shots and staying attached to people and trying to even play physical and bump guys off their own spots, if you will. But meanwhile, you know, the Golden State bench comes up with 45 points total, you know, to the Cavs bench, which only scores 10. And the key moment in this game was really the beginning of the fourth quarter, with Curry and Clay both out of the game. And then all of a sudden, Barbosa hits a shot, Livingston hits two or three in a row, Lou has to call a timeout, they come back again, Iguodala hits another shot, and they just end up running away with it and then extending the lead. The fact that they're able to do that with their two superstars out, Draymond was on the floor, but with their two superstars out of the game, that says a lot about this Golden State team. And that's what you want to look for, really, in a situation like this, is you know the sign of a good team. And this is why Golden State is an elite and a great team, because they found a way to win when they didn't have their two main guys going, and they locked down defensively, team-wise. Even with those two guys not going, their entire team locked down, and then you get 45 points off of your bench. Just a superb performance from the Golden State Warriors.
And we praise the Golden State Warriors because they're the team that shoots the three ball better than anybody that you can think of. Almost, you can make the argument they can shoot the three ball better than any team that we know of in NBA history. Tonight, they were only 9 for 27, Shaw. I mean, the Cleveland Cavaliers made as many three-pointers as the Golden State Warriors, so that was a push. In the beginning of this game, the first quarter, the effort of Andrew Bogut, which, I mean, we don't make recognition of, every now and again, Andrew Bogut will pull out some kind of game where he actually looks credible. He actually looks like he's contributing for the Warriors. He's not coming in on garbage time or you know, doing garbage minutes of big man work. He actually was setting the tone that this was going to be a defensive battle and that there were going to be no easy baskets. Now, the only easy baskets that we saw in the early outset was with LeBron James punishing people down low, starting from the top of the key and working his way down into the middle of the paint. But for everyone else, it was no easy picnic. Even Tristan Thompson, who is the king of offensive rebounds, he had a difficult time finishing shots on the putback. And a lot of that was because of the contest by Andrew Bogut and Draymond Green. And to me, that is totally key. I feel like what we saw from the Cleveland Cavaliers in the Eastern Conference playoffs and the whole run that they've made was a testament of going up against teams that obviously are not built in the same manner that the Golden State Warriors are. And even if you tried to pull a blueprint out of what the Golden State Warriors did to beat a team like the Cavaliers, if you don't execute it the way that the Warriors do, you still don't stand a chance to competing with the team like the Cavaliers. But the Cavaliers are going up tonight against really the best who is doing it right now. And this is exactly what's exposed the fallacies and why we don't feel as confident as we should about whether or not this Cavaliers team has the capabilities of running four games off against the Warriors.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a daunting task when you look at trying to defeat the Warriors four times in a series. And the Cavaliers, you look at game one now and say, well, damn, you know, especially when you get beat, you know, by 15 and believe with that 20 at some point. You start to really wonder, okay, well, where do we stand with this team? Like, are they just that much better than us? But it is only game one, and I think Lou has to go back now and make some proper adjustments. You know, everybody, you know, is a coach on Twitter, especially. So you're seeing all kinds of call for, you know, to give Fry more playing time to try to space the floor. You need to give maybe Mozgov some more playing time to try to control the rebounding, and then maybe he can help be a presence on the post. And again, Mozgov played great for them last year. You know, outside of LeBron, you know, really doing what he did. I think Mozgov was the Cleveland Cavaliers' second best player, arguably with Tristan, who was obviously a terror on the glass. But, you know, Mozgov can give you some things too. So I don't know if that's something that Lou will go to. And sometimes you don't feel like you're desperate after losing just one game. But in the manner in which you lost, and I say the manner in which you lost simply because their two superstars didn't produce, I think you do have to look at some early adjustments because you don't want to have this thing get away from you. You know, you're at some point you're going to have to win a game in Golden State. So why don't you try to make it your best shot and do that in game two?
All right, Sean, let me ask you this. Tonight, Kyrie Irving, 26, 3-4 with 3 steals, 3 turnovers. You look at that stat line. You know, that's very eerily similar to what he produced last year before he went down with his injury. I mean, how loud are these numbers? Are these numbers really saying something, or is it so much so that we're just going to be impressed with Kyrie Irving like we've always been impressed with Kyrie Irving? I mean, what's going to be the element for Kyrie Irving to really make these numbers stand out and have a significant impact to the Warriors' chances of being able to win this championship, if nothing else, keep up with what the Golden State Warriors backcourt and the team altogether is doing?
Well, I think with Kyrie, you're going to want to be looking at like the assist to turnover ratio and just even the total number of assists in general, and obviously his effective field goal percentage. I think if those are where they need to be, then Cleveland Cavaliers have a good chance. Again, I think a lot of the three main Cavs here, they had solid numbers statistically and from an aesthetic standpoint, but their percentages were really rough. And again, that was due to the lack of ball movement, you know, guys trying to force shots, guys trying to go up against 2 and 3 defenders, guys rushing things when the shot clock is winding down. That just wasn't good team basketball from the Cleveland Cavaliers. But specifically with Kyrie Irving, again, you want to see him being a guy who can penetrate. And we know he's not going to be a 10, 12, you know, 13 assist guy. He's not going to do what LeBron does on a regular basis. But he can get in those 5, 6, 7 assists a game. And then, you know, if he cuts down his turnovers to 1 or 2 and then shoots a decent percentage, I think the Cavaliers would be in a lot better position. If he's trying to penetrate, get into the middle of the floor and shoot that mid-range jumper that he can do, and especially with that step back, and not even necessarily rely on the three as much, you know, but I think he gets his mid-range going, that will open up the floor for him to even shoot the three later on down the line in the game. That's what I'm looking for Kyrie Irving, just overall effective efficiency and getting those assists up a little bit.
Tonight, Tyronn Lue ran Kevin Love, LeBron James, Tristan Thompson, Kyrie Irving, J.R. Smith. No less than 30 minutes for these guys on the basketball court. At some point, is this to me a trend that Tyronn Lue is going to roll with these guys for the majority? Or do you think that he should actually expand the lineup a little bit? I mean, Richard Jefferson had 12 minutes, but a lot of those minutes were, to me, garbage. Matthew Dellavedova only saw 11 minutes, which, you know, obviously he made a name for himself last year in the NBA Finals. Iman Shumpert had 17 minutes, albeit, though, I just don't know how much, like, to me, I'm just wondering what the rotation is going to be like for Tyronn Lue, because I really think that game two, there's a lot of implications, and we're planning to do our wrap up to discuss, you know, what may happen after game two if the Warriors or the Cavaliers win. But I'm just wondering, as we look forward to game two, what this lineup is going to really look like from a rotation perspective, because That's pretty heavy minutes for those five guys to be out there on the basketball court. And if Steve Kerr has the luxury of being able to sit Klay Thompson for a majority of the second half after he got that ridiculous third foul, right? And still is playing with a lead. I mean, if you're Steve Kerr, you got to feel good because you know at some point Klay Thompson, Steph Curry, Harrison Barnes, whoever is going to turn it on and help them spark that offense. Can Tyronn Lue afford to do that with his bench?
I don't know if he can afford to do it, but I think he does need to try to invoke a couple of different things and include a couple of wrinkles here. I think the most likely guy when it comes to offense, you're going to be looking for Fry to come off that bench and try to give them some scoring. Again, JR in the starting lineup didn't have a good game either, only took three shots. So you probably want to try to find a way to get him going too from a starting standpoint. But again, off the bench, Fry is a guy I think offensively, and I think Shumpert is somebody who you want to be able to try to get out there on the defensive side of things too to slow down some of their perimeter guys. And then you just hope that he can get in there, slash a little bit. If he stays in the corner, he can knock down that three. He's not a knockdown shooter, but he can hit it. And I think those are the two guys that are most primed for Lue to try to get some production from. Again, as I said earlier in the segment here, I don't know if he goes now and tries to, break the emergency glass and see what Mozgov can give them. Even if it is, 10, 12 minutes, let Mozgov come out there and say, all right, well, now here we're going to try to get some points in the paint as opposed to living on the perimeter so much. So he has some options. Again, he has to look at this tape and see what worked, which isn't a lot. But, again, I don't know if that he's scrapped his overall game plan and rotation because they lost by 15 tonight.
Kyle Lee, Warren Shaw, the Baseline NBA Podcast, discussing the NBA Finals Game 1 as the Golden State Warriors defeat the Cleveland Cavaliers 104-89. The Warriors take a 1-0 lead over the Cavaliers. Game 2 will take place Sunday night back at the Oracle. And, one of the caveats, Shaw, before we switch gears and we start talking about Steph Curry and to Klay Thompson and really that they were non-existent in tonight's game. The other caveat to me that was non-existent was J.R. Swish. I mean, J.R. basically played 30 minutes before he had an opportunity to make his first shot attempt. Only shot one three-pointer. I'm sorry, he only shot three three-pointers and only made one. I mean, is he really working that hard defensively? Is that what we're relying on? Is for him to be on the basketball court, he has to earn it by playing the defense? Because I would have thought that he would have been much more involved offensively to help this Cavaliers team try to pull this victory out to only have 3 points and really only shoot the ball three times in the course of 36 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, I'd have to really go back and look at some of the game myself, too. I'm not sure if he passed up a lot of shots. I mean, I know a lot was being made about him, the low shot attempts, especially for a guy who likes to let it fly. But I can't even recall, was it that he really just turned down some looks that he would have ordinarily taken? And, he likes to shoot with defense on him. So I guess that probably is to some degree.
That's got to make you wonder, though, Shaw. Like, is he getting absorbed in the criticism of what he did last year? Because last year, right, while we applauded that he was really the second best shooter that the Cavaliers had on that basketball court, everyone did question his shot selection against a team very finite and leaves you with little room for error. So now in this series, if you're thinking about that, and to your point, if he's deferring shots, then we're not talking about J.R. Swish that's going to take those shots that are necessary to really shake things up, maybe put the fear of Golden State's defense out there. So, to me, I just wonder about that as well, too.
Yeah, I mean, but again, I think it still all goes back to even LeBron and Kyrie and Lue to a much bigger degree as to okay, well, how are we going to get him going, and trying to set him up on the perimeter so that he can try to knock down a couple of threes or whatever. And I think Van Gundy even had a very good point at one point in the telecast where I think the Warriors were illegal on defense and they're saying, listen, you should let JR go here and shoot that free throw just so he can see the ball go in, shows that social trust in him there. Again, Kyrie went to the line and I believe he did make it in that point, and that was fine. But I think even little things like that, as a game manager, like that coaches really are, you need to look at that and say, okay, well, here's a chance for me to just have him see the ball go in the basket And I thought that was a great point by Van Gundy on the telecast.
And you would likely see that from Steve Kerr before you would see that from Tyronn Lue.
So, you know, yeah, and it would have been nice in that point. Again, not to say that it would have, you know, turned on the switch for him in this game or whatever, but every little bit helps. And I think in a series like this, and they got to find a way to get JR going, and JR's got to find a way to get himself going too. It can't just all be like, hey, guys, pass me the ball. You know, hey, he's got to make sure that he's moving around and getting open. And yeah, I know a lot was made about his defensive effort tonight and that he was, you know, he kept Clay, you know, pretty much locked down. But if that really affects his overall even shot attempts, then that's a problem. You know, that really is a problem. And I don't know if that means, okay, maybe he and Shumpert need to exactly split time down the middle, if you will. But one way or another, I think the Cavs are going to have a much better showing before all said and done in this series. It is only game one, and we'll see what adjustments Lue makes for game two.
Most definitely, Shaw. And to your point regarding the little things, the little nuances of things that you should look for that are depicting of a team who's been here before, understands the moment, understands what needs to happen and what kind of adjustments have to be made. And Steve Kerr actually, you know, taking accountability for how he wants his team to play. I mean, we saw him, you know, go dim mock on his coaching clipboard, when the Warriors just completely lost focus and allowed the Cavaliers to run off like seven straight points to cut a 20-point plus lead down back, to almost single digits. But to me, I think the other caveat was what Steve Kerr did from the very outset of this game. He inserted Harrison Barnes back in the starting lineup, where I think a lot of people felt like, you know, Andre Iguodala is better suited. He should probably be starting. He's definitely stepped up and he's made some great, great plays. But again, to Steve Kerr's point, and he said it in the post conference. He said, "Look, we feel like we shouldn't have to change what has gotten us to where we are unless it's absolutely necessary." And I think in that, he's rewarding Harrison Barnes by saying, we started this whole project from last year and we got a finals and a championship. Now, I changed it because of the situation regarding who we were playing against Oklahoma City. But tonight, we're going back to what our bread and butter. And Harrison Barnes, to his credit, rewarded Steve Kerr's decision by going out there, scoring the basketball, punishing the mismatches that he was given. He threw up 10 shots, which I like when Harrison Barnes throws up shots because it shows that he's aggressive and he's not one-track minded. And even though he didn't fill up the stat sheets, he still was effective. And that effectiveness is what helped stymie the spotlight on the lack of production regarding Steph Curry and Klay Thompson tonight.
Yeah, I think he started out 4 or 5 from the floor, if you will, finished 6 of 10. And, you know, he really picked his spots and I think he rewarded Kerr for that belief and that trust in him to put him back into the starting lineup. He definitely could have got down on himself a little bit and said, you know what, I'm not producing. But I think, you know, they had days to prepare for this. I'm sure Barnes knew ahead of time that he would be back in the starting lineup. And then he responded and he really delivered. And I think that's just something that, again, when you look at the totality of what the Golden State Warriors did this evening, it really was a team effort all the way through. You know, every man that came on the floor produced and did something positive for Golden State. And HB was definitely no different than that. And again, it's just, you like to see that, you know, especially for a young guy, and, you know, he's going to be going to free agency perhaps. And, you know, he could be thinking all kinds of things, but right now he's got to try to help this Golden State Warriors team repeat as NBA champions. And he really responded in game one.
Yeah, Lee Warrenshaw, the Baseline NBA podcast. We're discussing the NBA Finals. The Golden State Warriors knock off the Cleveland Cavaliers in game one, 104-89, Shaw. So, Shaw, before we start finalizing, you know, our final points, let's just quickly talk about Steph Curry and Klay Thompson. And I just want to get right to the point of this. You know, bad performances shooting-wise tonight. And really, when you look at Steph Curry, I think the big concern tonight was the 5 turnovers because, again, he fell into that lapse where he just makes these lazy passes. And I think at times, you know, this was the same issue that I had with him in game one last year. Part of it was because I felt like he just was not being aggressive. I can live with the fact that he can take the ball to the basket and, you know, it gets blocked, or, you know, he doesn't get like the foul call, or, you know, he's being triple teamed and it's just difficult for him to get his shots. But even if he's not doing that, he cannot afford to turn the ball over the way that he turns the ball over. Not the volume, but the way that he turns the ball over. And tonight, you could just clearly see Klay Thompson, I think, was so focused defensively that he zoned himself out when it mattered the most for him to take his offensive shots. With that being said, though, 4 for 15, 4 for 12, is that really a byproduct of good Cleveland Cavaliers defense? Or is that just a byproduct of two emotionally tired guys who just finished carrying their team down from a 3-1 deficit in the Western Conference Finals and didn't truly have their legs under them in game one of this finals?
Well, I think it's the latter primarily, but you do have to credit the Cleveland's defense. I think, again, one thing that they did do is they really crowded Curry for most of the night. There was times where there was no space, and even if they had to spy and put two and three guys on him, they did that, especially coming off screens where Curry was like, oh, I just need that centimeter. Oh, that centimeter of space isn't there. All right, you know, now I have Tristan Shumpert, you know, like swarming me. Let me move the ball. But to your point earlier about the turnovers, yeah, sometimes he is cavalier with the ball, no pun intended.
Yeah, there was.
He just needs to be more focused when it comes to that, because at this point of his career, a lot of things have been scouted, you know, and he likes to do that little, you know, dribble, that in and out dribble, cut to the lane, and off the screen, and the one guy kicks out to the corner, he'll throw it over his shoulder. You saw OKC scout that out, sniff that out many times in the last series, and I think teams in general
telegraphed it tonight yeah. again. Yeah,
and then teams have that down pack. So he's got to find a new trick in his game, if you will, a new wrinkle when it comes to that pass or even that just overall play. And that's even partly on Kerr too, but definitely from Curry's standpoint, to not just make a blind pass. Okay, I know he's going to be there, because right now the defense is who's there. But again, I do think they really did crowd the space of both of those guys, and they forced the other guys to beat them, and it happened. I mean, you really do have to kind of tip your cap. All the other Warriors, you know, produce and beat the Cleveland Cavaliers. So I don't think you go ahead and change that per se, and I don't think that Curry and Klay will play that badly again combined. But you do typically want to try to stop one of those guys and see if you can slow down the rest of them as you go.
All right, Shaw. So all that being said, and I think we've done a really good job here breaking down, you know, things that we saw in reference to game one. And like you said earlier, this is only one game, and I completely agree. But when you do look at this for what it is one game that the Cleveland Cavaliers now don't have the luxury of basically saying we have a lead, or it is one less now that they have to account for the opposing team to being closer to the championship. So with that being said, game two, Oracle, how important is this, is that game for the Cleveland Cavaliers?
Well, I mean, every game is important in the NBA Finals, but like I said, we know they have to get one, at least. They're going to have to get one in Oracle, and it might as well be that one. I thought this would have been their best chance tonight in game one.
Thought so. I thought so, too, and I really felt like the way that the Warriors were getting their shots, despite us applauding a better defensive effort by the Cleveland Cavaliers, I thought it was a flawed strategy. And then you can also make the argument that because these guys just didn't hit shots, the main shot makers didn't hit shots, this could have been a far worse loss for them. And I just felt like there's no excuse, knowing that you had all of this rest, all of this time to prepare. And you can clearly see that this is not a crisp Warriors team, but clearly they're a deep Warriors team. And you made it that much easier for them to get better looks at the basket. That's a concern.
Yeah, no, it definitely is. And that's, to some degree, you kind of just say, you know what, maybe it was an anomaly. To some degree, you did what you wanted to do in terms of containing Curry and Klay, but other guys really did come step up and beat you. Even Draymond had a damn near triple-double, 16, 11, and 7, 4 steals. You know, he's somebody who can, you know, really affect the game on both sides of the basketball, but even he can be the straw that stirs the drink, if you will, for their offense at times too. I think Cleveland has a decent strategy in place, you know, from a defensive standpoint. And again, I don't think that they shoot that bad again, but same thing. I don't think the Warriors bench contributes as much as they get. I mean, Livingston was 8 of 10. He was 80% from the floor. So, I mean, that was outstanding, and primarily on jumpers. So I think to some degree you can say, okay, defensively we did some of the things that we wanted to do, but I think the Cavs offense is what really failed them tonight. And again, you have to credit to the Golden State defense for what they were able to do to stop Cleveland's offense tonight.
So if the Cleveland Cavaliers lose game two, we're saying all is not completely lost, but I mean, what's the danger level then? You know what I'm saying? Are we talking, Bermuda Triangle, or are we talking about, well, you know, they're just treading dangerous waters?
No, I think it's Bermuda Triangle. You know, you go down, you know, 0-2, even going home now, you're going to be clearly on your heels. And a lot of times, you know, the experts and said if Lou doesn't make, you know, semi-major adjustments in game two, then you're probably going to see drastic adjustments in game three when they get back on their home floor. And then you just have to see if those are the things that work out for you. And then if not, then you find yourself down 0-3, and then the series really is over. I just want to see Cleveland with a better overall effort offensively. And that's just not something that you would think you'd be talking about in this series, especially from their standpoint, with the way that they've been playing, you know, in the playoffs. It's just you didn't think their offense would fail them, and it did tonight. So Lou's got to find a way to get that going. And if they go down 0-2, there's not a chance in hell they can go down 0-3 and have a chance to win.
Golden State Warriors tonight shot 49.4%, while the Cleveland Cavaliers shot 38%. Again, another great defensive effort by the Warriors, holding the Cavaliers under 90 points in game one. They win it 104-89. Finally, Shaw, the deli shot heard around the world to Andre's Iggy's. Is that fair or foul, brother? Is that fair or foul when it comes to the man, Jules?
I don't think he did it on purpose. Even just looking at the replay, he was reaching in for the ball. He swiped and missed. And
is
then
that what you? Is that what you saw?
I did. I don't. I mean, again, I'm not a Delly fan. But I think he swiped and missed, and he was like kind of looking.
I don't think Andre Iguodala is a Delly fan either. After that, by the way.
Well, I mean, again, and obviously there's history here from last year, and you know how Delly was on the ground. He was, you know, breakdancing and sweeping the leg, you know, all through the last NBA Finals. But I think in this specific instance, and even with the referees going back and looking at it, I just don't think it was intentional. And Delly's not somebody who I'd ever give the benefit of the doubt.
Any man that gets smacked in, listen, you just finished giving Draymond Green a flagrant 2, right, on Steven Adams. And everyone kept saying, well, you know, Draymond Green flailed a leg, but I don't think he intended to kick him in the man, Jules. But then they call that foul to Andre Iguodala a common foul. There ain't nothing common getting knocked up in the man, Jules, man.
Well, I mean, this is definitely the year, you know, of protecting nuts when it comes to the NBA playoffs. So everybody,
that,
you know,
that, would, going that would definitely be a Wu-Tang remix. Yes.
100, protect your nuts. And I think everybody
now,
needs
now to go to we're going to have Matthew Dellavedova and RZA come together with the man with the two iron fists part two.
Not ready.
Not ready.
These guys, need to invest in some cups. I know it's not real cool to wear those things in 2016, but it just seems to be that, you know, a lot of people keep getting hit and below the belt. But in this instance, again, I just don't feel like Delly did it on purpose, but it doesn't make it okay.
Yeah, listen, I can already see Poppy on ESPN's Highly Questionable. Just ring the alarm, ding, 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 like crazy. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, look, we can definitely argue that point. I don't like putting people out there. Well, then again, unless you're Drake, I don't like putting people out there. But as far as I'm concerned, I think Delly knew exactly where the ball was at the time that he swung for it, and you know, he just wanted to make sure. Listen, if I'm gonna miss, I'm gonna hit. So, you know, if I'm Andre Iguodala, I might take that a little personally, man, because you should miss when you're going down there like that. You need to hit the kneecap. You know what I'm saying? Bust the kneecap. But you can't bust up a man's man, Jules, bro. You can't do that. That's
Delly with a junk punch. Yeah.
Anyway, man, what an awesome show as we give you the post-game review discussion with the NBA Finals Game 1, the Golden State Warriors knocking off the Cavaliers 104-89, Game 2, Sunday night. Of course, you, my man Shaw, and I, we will be back. We will give our insight and take, and we would definitely like to invite you and yours to jump on and take a listen here on the Baseline NBA Podcast. And again, man, just awesome stuff, man. And what a – listen – it's an excellent way for us to review the series because it wasn't spectacular. It wasn't awestruck, but that just means that it's gonna get good and it's percolating, especially if we called it this being a 7-game series.
Yeah, I think it was a bit of an ugly game in general. I mean, you see Golden State scored over 100 points, no doubt, but it just didn't have a lot of flow to it. But it did in spurts, where they, especially when Golden State was scoring all those points in the fourth quarter. So we'll see how both teams adjust. I think Kerr realizes he found a little bit of fool's gold, if you will, with the bench producing as efficiently and as effectively as they did. So he's going to find some ways to get Clay and Curry some more space, too, on their shots. But game two is all about the adjustments, and I can't wait to see how both teams play.
Most definitely. So for the Baseline, Cal Lee, Warren Shaw, We appreciate you guys. Be sure to check us out as the Baseline Podcast will be rocking and rolling again. And we will definitely do our post-game review after game two. Be sure to check us out here at NBA Baseline. For the Baseline, Cal Lee, Warren Shaw. We appreciate you guys, and we'll catch up with you next time.